coming to the top of the stretch, and Track L has lost the lead. It's Exotic Wood on the outside, and He's a Bull. That half in 43 and 4/5 seconds. Confide is coming up the inside. Men's Exclusive and Bet on Sunshine is at the rail. Into the last furlong. It's He's a Bull with the short lead. Exotic Wood giving her all on the outside. Bet on Sunshine, and here comes Elmhurst.
Welcome back to another edition of A Case for Racing Immortality here on Racing Rundown. And today we get to talk about a very interesting, a very talented rider, Corey Nakatani. Got his big break in the early 90s on the Southern California circuit at a very young age. He was only in his early 20s when he kind of got his big break. Started riding in 1998, picked up his mounts gradually in 1989. His first real big horse was a horse by the name of It's All Greek to Me. And then he became associated with Wayne Lucas. And obviously at that time, Wayne Lucas was kind of the big man on campus, the rider, or the trainer, I should say, that everyone wanted to be riding for. And Corey Nakatani was fortunate enough to pick up mounts for him early. Some of his earliest successes came on a horse named Serena Song, a very talented mare who took Corey to a lot of big places, including being one of the favorites for the 1995 Kentucky Derby. The Breeders' Cup is where Corey Nakatani kind of made his mark, though. 10 wins in 90 starts with 10 seconds and 12 thirds. So over 30% in the money, as well as just around an 11% winner. His biggest accomplishment was winning 3 Breeders' Cup sprints in a row from 1996 to 1998, including 2 times aboard Janine Sahadi-trained Elmhurst and Lita Justice in 1996 and 1997 from last to first, some of his best rides ever. He actually won 4 sprints in all, also adding one in 2006 on Thor's Echo. In addition, in 2004, he won the Juvenile Fillies on a very talented filly named Sweet Catamine, where he had loads of trouble at the top of the stretch, yet somehow weaved her through traffic and got her to the winner's circle. Corey Nakatani, one of his biggest claims to fame has to be his turf experience. He was one of the better turf riders of the recent 30 or so years, pretty much winning every single race he could win on the West Coast, on the grass, a 3-time winner of the Hollywood Turf Cup, Hollywood Derby, so on and so forth. Those are probably 2 of the biggest at the time races you could win. Eddie Reed is another one. He won that 5 times in his career. In addition, he won the Canadian International once and Dubai Golden Shaheen once. He was very talented all across the globe. Wherever he could get a ride, he was a winner. In addition to all of that, he won a riding title at all 4 of the major meets in the time period, which he rode 3 at Del Mar, 4 at the Oak Tree meet, which was the fall meet at Santa Anita, 2 at Santa Anita spring meet, and 1 at Hollywood Park as well. The biggest negative in Corey's career would have to be the fact he never won a Triple Crown race. In his long and illustrious career, which wrapped up in 2018, which he was actually essentially forced to stop after suffering a very bad neck and spine injury in a fall, something that unfortunately hindered the later part of his career. The last 10 years or so were marked by just injury after injury. Every time he seemed to come back, he would unfortunately suffer another injury. But getting back to the Triple Crown aspect, only once in his career did he ever place in a Triple Crown race. That was a 2nd in the Kentucky Derby in 2011 aboard the Steve Asmussen-trained Nero. And as I mentioned earlier, he did ride Serena Song, one of the favorites for the Kentucky Derby, but nevertheless wasn't able to win that race because Serena Song just didn't seem ready for it, and he just never seemed to have a Triple Crown mount worth mentioning. He never really had that talented horse after her. One thing he did do very well, though, was win the Kentucky Oaks twice very early on in his career. 1991, the Kentucky Oaks win that year kind of burst him onto the scene when he won it for the Jerry Hollendorfer-trained filly Light. In addition, 1996, he would go on to win it with another Jerry Hollendorfer-trained filly, Pike Place Dancer. She was about 40-1 on that day. So the 90s were probably the shining moment of Corey Nakatani's career. Was marked by 5 Breeders' Cup wins all in the later half of the 1990s. 2000s were also successful for him, but like I said, the injuries did kind of hold him back. All in all, though, he never really had the win amount that would, you know, be super impressive, but the earnings were always there. Top 10 in earnings 5 or 6 times throughout his career in the United States, After 2000, I should say, in the 90s, he was also very highly ranked in those aspects as well. The crowning thing about Corey will always be how he rode the grass races on the West Coast, even towards the later part of his career. If you had Corey Nakatani on your horse on the grass at Santa Anita or Del Mar, you were in a good position to have your horse in the winner's circle. Pretty much every graded stakes on the West Coast, he was able to win at some point or another. Overall, if we're talking about whether or not Corey should be in the Hall of Fame, I believe yes. I think he won so many graded stakes throughout his career. From the very beginning to the very end, he was very talented in finding really good mounts and getting him in the winner's circle. And it didn't always have to be a favorite either. He could get a long shot into the winner's circle just as easy as he could get a favorite in the winner's circle, especially on the grass. I mean, I've touched on that point a bunch, but it is true. He did have a lot of success when he was able to ride on the grass. And even though he never really had a major Triple Crown mount, he rode tons of nice horses throughout his career. Lava Man is his highest career earner, and obviously a very talented horse. He rode Lava Man in pretty much all of his big races. Sand Pit, another horse for Richard Mandela, who he rode for a lot in the late 90s, probably the prime of his career. He rode Sand Pit as well as Seraphine for Richard Mandela. Even then, he had a solid association with Bob Baffert for a time, riding one of Bob Baffert's better horses in the 90s, General Challenge. And we already talked about his sprinters in Lita Justice, Elmhurst, Re-Rays, and even more so, another very talented filly who never broke through on the Breeders' Cup stage in Sharp Cat. He earned $1 million on her. So I think Corey Nakatani, based off of all that, should be in the Hall of Fame, especially his Breeders' Cup record should be able to put him over the hump there. Also earned over $230 million in his career, quite a bit of money. It's one of the highest, I believe it's top 10 of all time for riders, in addition to being a 45% in the money rider as well, which is a very high percentage in that regard. I think that should be enough, even though he never had the Triple Crown fame that one jockey would expect and kind of the benchmark for what makes a great rider. I think he made up for that with all of his success in races like the Breeders' Cup and everyday riding in graded stakes on the Southern California circuit. So for me, I hope Corey Nakatani gets into the Hall of Fame. Hopefully it's this year, but I think down the road, even then, we'll see him in there at some point. So that'll wrap it up for this edition of A Case for Racing Immortality. I'm Eric DeCoster, and we'll see you next time.